Good afternoon, Calicut. A warm welcome to Sri Kapil Sibal. I'm actually honored to host this show, if it need to be said as a show. But I'm sure that I have been observing Mr. Kapil Sibal for almost 3 decades. The first interface I had of Mr. Sibal was the way he was arguing, defending Justice Ramaswamy in Lok Sabha on the impeachment motion. The brilliance we could all see, and it was manifested. And from that, there was no looking back. And Mr. Sibal has been one of the most prominent faces of our national polity. And let me start this session by asking you, sir, one question. I did listen to your speech on the CAA in Rajya Sabha. And you concluded your speech by making this point. The country, how can we expect these people to guide this country? Of these people who has no idea about India.
Those who have no idea of India cannot protect India and protect the idea of India. See, they have no idea of history. They have no idea of what we went through during the course of the national movement. They only have an idea of the experiment that they did in Gujarat, and they think they can replicate it in the rest of India.
But they have a different idea. The idea of bigotry, idea of discrimination, and which is being manifested in the CAA,
well, NRC. That's their DNA. So what
DNA,
do?
Yeah. Now the question is that how are you going to tackle this? How are you going to protect this country?
That's how.
Yeah. And I think the quiz of Calicut have been conversed here. That shows the emphasis on which people of Kerala want to fight this so-called regime of bigotry and...
See, Kerala, according to me, one of the most educated state in this country. Right? Kerala has people who have an open mind, and they have lived for hundreds and hundreds of years. Calicut has a great history, as you know. Yeah. Right?
Kapil sir, every institution is under attack, and even the judiciary is not immune from that. And as a brilliant lawyer, and I think you would be one of the brilliant lawyers of this country, what do you feel that even the people who lose their, I would say, their trust in the judiciary, where are we supposed to look up?
No, I see, I think these are passing phases in the history of a nation. You must remember that. Nothing is permanent. What goes up comes down, has to come down. Now, what we need to do is to have confidence in ourselves and what we stand for, and not worry about what is, I think, a transient phase in the history of this country. And what I believe, and we all should believe in, hope that all we need to do is to fight together, and we will stand with every citizen of this country who believes in the idea of India. And therefore, I think that we should not worry about some problems that arise in institutions. Remember, today, the Constitution is irrelevant for this government, completely irrelevant. And what they have done is they have slowly subverted the Constitution, not through constitutional means, but to extra constitutional means. They have captured, they are trying to capture, and to some extent captured, educational institutions. Yeah. They have set up their own RSS people as vice chancellors.
And the
they have captured the media,
yeah,
big time, as you know.
Media
the nation always wants to know. Right? And they've captured industry, because industry has a lot of investments in their ventures. They have to come to government for favors. So they've captured industry, right? And all the governors in this country, including the one that's...
The Kerala people would be waiting to hear something about the governor from you.
I'll certainly put
because
a bit
because he has been dwelling on legal aspects, constitutional aspects, you being a...
I know Arif Muhammad Khan for a long time.
Yeah. What could be the one-line definition you would be given to the governor of Kerala now?
See, the governor of Kerala needs to read the constitution.
That's all.
That's enough.
That
and
is
if,
enough.
And if he finds it a little difficult, I can help him a bit.
But he had various manifestations. He started as a congressman, joined many parties. Now he
started as a congressman, joined the Janata Dal.
Yeah.
Then BSP. Was then born in limbo for a while.
Yeah.
And now he's found his real comfort corner.
No, when you see all these polemics, I mean, as a lawyer of this country, one of the leading lawyers, how do you read? Actually, I mean, those people who are supposed to be knowledgeable about the constitution, the legal aspects, if they talk like this, what could be their main hope for the
government? Your assumption is wrong. They are not knowledgeable about the constitution, including the Prime Minister of India and the Home Minister of India. They are not knowledgeable. If they were knowledgeable, they would not be doing what they are doing.
One of the tasks of this India is supposed to be the opposition. There is an overwhelming feeling that the opposition also doesn't work.
No. Yeah. Remember.
Yeah, that's a feeling.
The opposition doesn't drive the car, unfortunately. I wish we were driving the car.
No, even the Stephanie is punctured.
Everything is punctured. You see, this is the problem. The opposition needs to get together. It's act.
Yeah.
We've not been able to get together our act. And I think ultimately somebody will emerge from the people of this country to lead this country. Has to. We have to protect.
Mr. Sibal is a perpetual optimist, which I can see. I have been observing. Let me ask you a question, because now you can see the array of people here, Calicut, the Scottish people have come on here, and they are hearing you. See, we have set a model, Kerala has set a model on the CEA, on this NRC. Cutting across the party lines, people have been converging and fighting as one soul. And what could be your take on that? Should the Kerala people, should the political parties in Kerala, should come together and fight, or should they tread on their parochial political lines? What could be your view?
There's no question of treading on parochial lines. Remember, see, if you look at the scenario in Kerala, there are two parties, and both of them are anti-BJP. So let them fight with each other in Kerala, no problem. But when you come to national politics, the only alternative nationally is the Congress party. There is no other alternative. Nobody else can fight this battle. You know, the CPM can fight this battle, try to fight this battle in West Bengal. They are losing. They have lost. Kerala, of course, the battle is going on. That's fine. But when you come to national politics, I think we all must stand together, because this is a national legislation. So we shouldn't be scoring political points. You must know that if the CAA is passed, no state can say, I will not implement it. That's not possible. That is unconstitutional. You can oppose it. You can pass a resolution in the assembly and ask the central government to say, please withdraw it. But constitutionally, to say that I will not implement it is going to be problematic. And it's going to create more difficulty. So what we need to do is politically get together, fight this battle, and let the Congress party nationally lead the charge.
Mr. Sibal, when you talk about the Congress party, obviously a lot of people will be having a thought in their mind. See, Congress is not rising to the occasion to be the principal political party to take on the BJP. There's a huge vacuum that has been created. I do understand that people like you, of course, go for a fight, which is very valuable. But there is a vacuum that has been created.
Yes.
So do you feel that, you see, Congress also need to mend this base and to become the principal political...
See, when you say also needs to mend its ways, everybody must mend their ways. The problem is that there are now regional parties who have national ambitions. This is the heart of the problem.
Mr. Sibal, the possibility of a grand opposition coalition against the BJP. As you rightly said, there are a lot of contradictions, because some of the regional parties have got national ambitions or aspirations. So how are you going to tackle these contradictions?
No, I don't have the answer to that, quite frankly.
That is the only question where Mr. Sibal doesn't have an answer.
No.
Yeah.
No, this is an answer.
Yeah.
That I don't have an answer.
And when we talk about, I mean, you have been very optimistic that this would pass by. But if you look at the history, all these fascist regimes have been defeated not by the people of that country. Because of the external, extraneous reasons, they got dethroned. And in India, so you can see Modi has been obviously ruling. He came back in the second time. And people are little pessimist, because basically there is a vacuum, that is opposition, And on a national level, there is nobody to take on Modi because you don't have an equivalent of Modi. Your leaders always vanish. Mr. Rahul Gandhi, including, he just go away.
See, you are now talking about leaders versus leaders. I'm talking about a leader versus the people of India.
That's now, you mean to say the people of India is against Modi?
The people of India will rise, and they are rising, and you can see them rising.
Okay.
You see, university students have no political agenda, and you can't recognize a university student by his clothes, as the Prime Minister says. Right? You can only recognize by the emotion that you see in the course of these protests. These protests are not based on any politics. And why are kids in this country protesting? They are protesting because they don't see a future for themselves. They don't see a future for themselves. They don't have jobs. The economy is going to grow at 5%, but Subramanian has said actually it's 2% less or 2.5% less.
GDP.
It's growing at 2.5% GDP.
Even Subramanian Swami says so.
Yeah, Subramanian Swami, of course, is bound to say so.
For a different reason.
So that's what's the state of unemployment? Highest unemployment in the last 60-odd years, 45-odd years. The most dangerous thing is that consumption levels in rural India has gone down to levels of 1975. They've gone down by 3%. That's very dangerous. That's why I said the issue is not leader versus leader. It's leader versus the people of India.
Sir, having an approval for your points, I think at the same time, you need to have somebody to take on Modi.
See, remember, when you talk about somebody to take on Modi, it will happen.
It will happen. It will emerge.
And this second, happen. That's the nature of politics.
And second thing, just to supplement what you said, now we are obviously underlining the importance of the student struggle which are happening in JNU and Jamia. I'm glad that I studied in JNU. But the point is that it's the students which are spearheading this agitation, not the politicians.
Thank God. No, I seriously mean it. That's why it's making an impact. Because globally and within the country, people are realizing that this is not politics, this is real. These are students and ordinary middle class, lower middle class people coming out. They're not sort of connected to any political party. So the people of India are showing their angst, their concerns, their worry about the future of India. Everybody wants development. And what Modi has done is ensured his own development rather than the development of the country. So that's the worry. That's the worry Modi should have. And our concern should be, actually we want the country to back on the rails. But I don't think they have the wherewithal, they have the talent actually to bring the country back on the rails.
Sibalji, I mean, you mentioned and referred to C and NRC. See, Kerala has been up in arms against this CA as well against NPR and NRC. And technically you were saying that it is very difficult to say that we won't implement a law passed by the parliament. But the Kerala government has taken a position that they will not cooperate with CA or the NRC. And likewise, I think many of the other governments also have said, technically you are correct. But if a state government or rather if a dozen state governments do not cooperate with this NRC-CIA process. Where are you going to see this?
I think the answer has to be at two levels. What you're sending is a message to the Union of India that all states are unhappy with the CAA and the NRC and the National Population Register. That's a message that is being sent. I wish the Union of India hears that message. But at another level, the NRC is based on the National Population Register.
Correct.
And the National Population Register is to be implemented by the local registrar. And the local registrar has to be appointed at the level of the community in which that enumeration is to take place. And those have to be state-level officers.
Exactly.
So what is being said is that we will not allow the state-level officers to cooperate with the Union of India. That's what is being said.
All right.
Practically, whether that's possible or not, I'm not too sure.
Okay. It's a gray area.
It's a gray area. But constitutionally, it will be difficult for any state government to say that I will not follow a law passed by parliament.
And one more thing, the now Supreme Court would be hearing the case on that.
Yeah, yeah. So we'll await the Supreme Court.
As a senior lawyer, what could you foresee in Supreme Court?
No.
You won't prejudge.
I tell you why, I'll tell you because you can never know a judge's mind. Right? I can't even know my wife's mind, forget about it.
That is applicable to everybody.
At least there's some element of commonality.
Commonality for all the whites. But sir, I mean, when you heard what Supreme Court said about the JNU and Jamia issues, do you think that you need to expect much more from the Supreme Court?
No, see, I don't want to comment on institutions. I leave to Modi and Amit Shah. But I think that my perspective is the following. There are some urgent issues. Take Jammu Kashmir. What happened in Jammu Kashmir? Whatever they did under Article 370, whether it is right or wrong, I won't comment on them now. But that matter has not been heard till date. So there's an element of urgency, right? If violence is taking place in Jamia, or violence is taking place in JNU, these are matters of urgency, because violence taking place in Uttar Pradesh, around, figures are different, around 22 people have been killed in Uttar Pradesh alone, and by use of force. These are matters of urgency. At some level, the judiciary must show an element of urgency and take them up quickly.
Which you don't see in judiciary nowadays?
Some they do, some they don't. But, you know, I think that that people expect the judiciary to take up these matters.
Expectations.
Sometimes courts do not rise up to those expectations. Sometimes they do.
And with regard to the UP, there is a fact-finding team which has come out with a report. And, you know...
No, it is shocking. What is happening in UP is shocking. What happened, in fact, even in Mangalore is even more shocking. You went to a hospital which is administered by minorities, and you went to inside the hospital and you attacked people, police attacked people. That's unheard of. I've never heard anything like this. So, but this is... You see, you must understand there is a common thread since 2014, about the attitude of this government.
I was watching Netflix from the series about, web series about Hitler. You can see similarities on that. Hitler's political party was a socialist party, obviously. And Hitler promised food and jobs for the people. Here we have a national party. Here we have Achadin promised. See the analogy which is obviously...
This is what we need to understand. See, there are 130 crore people in India. Okay? Now, of that, about 80 to 90 crore earn less than 10,000 rupees a month. If you talk, 80, 90 crores is the population of Europe and America put together, earn less than 10,000 rupees a year, not a month, a year. So if you tell them that tomorrow will be better for you, if you sell them a dream, they'll buy it. What does a poor woman when she gets up in the morning and she doesn't have a school for her child to go to, doesn't have enough food for her child, she just has glazed eyes, she doesn't know what this evening will bring for her, whether the husband will come back home drunk or not. What hope does she have? And what Modi did was to sell a dream.
Yeah.
And we fell for it, and they have to fall for it. There's no choice. But you can't say that, look, you want to continue to live this life. If somebody says, I'll give you this, 15 lakh rupees in your bank account, of course you'll wait for him. Give it to me, I'll vote for him. Shocking, but this is what happened.
The RSS leaders have been privately saying that, see, whatever is happening on NRC or CAA, the Hindi hinterland, the polarization is going to help them.
Yes,
so basically, sum and substance is that BJP has gained out of the so-called...
No, it has not.
I'm not talking about Kerala, I'm talking about the core states.
No, even the other states. Where it may have gained a little bit is Uttar Pradesh because of the yogi sitting there. May have gained. In Uttar Pradesh alone. But I don't think they have gained in Bihar, I don't think they have gained in Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh. I don't think so.
But sir, I do come to Delhi. Let us see the principal political parties of this country. SP and BSP and UP. Minus certain references, they are not in the field. And even in Delhi, I won't see Aam Aadmi Party putting their heart into the fight against the CAA. So there is a reticence on the part of many political parties. They are little afraid to take on BJP, thinking that they will lose the BJP.
But if that's the Hindu case, votes. If that's the case, they would have won in Maharashtra, they would have won in Haryana, they would have won in Chattisgarh, they would have won in Jharkhand. They lost everywhere.
It's because
so I don't think that agenda is working anymore.
You mean to say the so-called polarization will not work in future?
No, it may work in some areas, but nationally, no. And even in the northern, in the northern belt, no, not in the Hindi-speaking states, not on all states. Not in all states.
Now the all organizations in India are under attack, all institutions are under attack.
Right.
And there is something called majoritarianism that is being thrust on us.
Right.
And there is something called military worship. And one important point which obviously you try to underline is the role of the media,
right,
which we claim to be the fourth pillar.
Right.
But that is one institution that has caved into Modi nicely or easily. How do you see the media scape of this country?
I have said enough on the media. I've been saying this all the time. But the point is that we have to dismantle the connection between industry and the media. And I think the Congress party should come out and say that if and when the opposition say if and when they come to power, industry have no role to play in setting up of media houses. No question about that. This has to be a people's thing, as the BBC. And other parts of it. If you allow industry to control media, government will control industry and in that process control the media. So we have to change this model.
See, as a lawyer, of course, you have every freedom to practice your cases, to represent your clients. But what could be the extent of conflict between a lawyer and a politician?
I'll tell you.
Yeah. Because I can also say, when your leader Rahul Gandhi was fighting Anil Ambani, on a different case, you were appearing for Anil Ambani in Supreme Court.
No, that's right.
Yeah, that's what I mean. So that could be the extent of conflict. I'm just asking.
There's no conflict at all.
Yeah.
Where's the conflict? Conflict is if in the same case you're representing two different points of view. On one day you appear for one client, the other day you appear for another client. Lots of people who belong to the BJP have been doing that, not me.
Not me alone.
Not me. Never do it. I've never done it in my life.
Yeah.
Never. I don't allow it to happen. No, we have kept the highest standards of morality as far as law is concerned. But yes, there is sometimes a conflict because your party takes a position, say on the Ram Janmabhoomi issue, right? And therefore, it would be embarrassing for me to appear for certain parties, so we don't appear, right? And many a times this has happened that the party is taking a position and we opt out of the litigation just to avoid a conflict. So that's all that it is.
We have many more questions, but we have run out of time.
But so I want to just say something to the audience, which I said to Mr. Modi, and I'll repeat it to you. I wrote a little poem for him.
Poem for him?
For him.
Yeah, okay, right, yeah.
It's in Hindi. I hope you understand it. Khuda ke bande sambhal ja. Khuda ke bande sambhal ja, waqt hai, abhi badal ja. Khuda ke bande sambhal ja, waqt hai, abhi badal ja. मत कर एक दूजे पे हमला कुछ ही दिनों का है जुमला मत कर एक दूजे पे हमला कुछ ही दिनों का है जुमला शहनशाह की आदत भुला के नफरत के बीच दफना के इंसान बन के दिखा दे
थैंक यू वेरी मच इट्स अ ग्रेट मैसेज बट दिस आर टाइम्स व्हेन पोएट्स आर बीइंग इंप्लिकेटेड इवन द ग्रेट उर्दू पोएट फैज अहमद फैज इज बीइंग आई मीन पुट इनटू कल
लाजिम है कि हम भी देखेंगे
हम देखेंगे सो वी विल एंड द सेशन बाय सेइंग हम देखेंगे